Please welcome now Nat Sakimura from the OpenID Foundation. Now, one of the great things about these sort of conferences is that you get to, in 20 minutes, to get an update on things that you never really have enough time to really get over. So we're going to find out about the what's new in the specs of OAuth and OpenID.
All right. Hi, I'm Nat Sakimura, the chairman of the OpenID Foundation. Some of you may know me, but I've been working on digital identity for the past 20 years, and OpenID Connect, JWT, JUT, right? OAuth, Pixie, among other things, some of the things that I helped create. And so what am I going to talk about today? As the title suggests, it's about the new developments around FAPI. So you guys were in the Gavin Littlejohn session this morning in the keynote?
Yeah.
He talked about FAPI too. That's exactly what I'm going to talk about. But before diving into it, I actually want to ask one question. Could you show your hand how many of you know FAPI? Very little, very little. So then I probably need to explain a little bit before coming to the new developments. By the way, you know OAuth, do you? Show your hand. Okay. Do you know OpenID Connect? Okay. Right. So FAPI basically is it stands for financial grade API. Aiming, it basically is the OAuth profile, an OpenID Connect profile, which aims to serve medium to high security profile. Now, when we talk about security, not everything needs to be done at the protocol layer. For example, in this picture, it's a little bit hard to talk like this. In this picture, do you see my finger? Probably not. In some environments where the environment protection is pretty high, like in the closed circuit system, then the protocol itself can be quite relaxed because there's other layers of protection, right? Or when there's the data that you are going to be protecting is not of very high value, then still you could use not very secure but easy to use kind of protocol, like in social many social sharings. But in case of financial transactions or medical transactions, something like that, that doesn't. You actually need to be pretty careful on what you're going to be using to protect. And you have to pick the right options in OAuth and OpenID Connect. When you say OAuth, people usually talk about RFC 6749 and RFC 6750. That's bearer token. But there are other options, other OAuth specs that you actually want to deploy in this kind of scenario. The problem with RFC 6749 is that it's not complete with source, destination, and message authentication, right? In the case of authorization request, sender authentication is there directly if you're using confidential client, using code flow, but there's no receiver authentication or message authentication. The message goes through the browser, right? And since it's browser bound, the TLS actually breaks there, which means there's an opportunity for minor errors to happen there and some further messages. In the case of authorization response, there's no sender authentication. You don't know where the returning packets from the authorization server is actually coming from. And the same with the receiver authentication, and there's no message authentication as well. So that's not a very good point when you think about security. What FAPI tries to address is to secure all these red points and make it green. And we have four implementers draft. Implementers draft means that its API is fixed, mostly done, but we still need to implement and get feedback from the implementers to fix or fine-tune that. And some standardization organization just writes a document, issues it, publishes it, but in our case, at OpenID Foundation, we always do multiple implementers draft, incorporating implementation experiences. We are writing the specification in human language, which means still we try to be very precise, but there still can be some difference in interpretation, which may cause interoperability issues. So we have four implementers. Part one is read-only security profile. Part two is read and write security profile. So part one is trying to address the medium security level thing, and part two is trying to address the high security thing. And part three, client initiated backchannel authentication profile has been developed quite recently, and there's another one called JAUT secured authorization response mode for all the two. And there are other companion specs like cross-browser payment initiation tag, which is explaining how these attack actually happens, and implementation deployment advice. They are not specs, it's kind of white papers, but it's good to read in the document. Then there's OAuth 2.0 mutual TLS client authentication and certificate bound access code. Name is very long. It's typical of our IETF specs. We have brought this into IETF, and we are, because it's usable elsewhere, right, as well. So we are doing the IETF. We've got, at OpenID Foundation, we've got the habit of trying to develop it within ourselves. And then when we think that this is actually of general, more wider applicability, we bring it to IETF to do the further standardization. And that's what's happening there. OAuth 2.0 JAUT secure authorization request, which should be published pretty soon, I think. That's actually taking up part of OpenID Connect into all, because that's actually generally useful. And OAuth 2.0 push authorization request, that's been the FAPI part 2 section 7 before. We're now putting that into the IETF because this is also very useful in other parts. And then there's a new shiny thing called OpenID Connect for Identity Assurance 1.0, which is talking about eKYC. And we are actually going to set up a new working group for eKYC and Identity Assurance pretty soon, maybe by the beginning of December. So, part one, part two, read-only security profile, read and write security profile. They use redirect approach. In general, in PSD2 speak, there are three approaches: redirect approach, decoupled approach, and embedded approach. And these two are talking about redirect approach. And here, authorization request is protected by JAUT protected request object, or JAUT protected request authorization request, from JAR, right? So there's a sender authentication, receiver authentication, and message authentication, because it's signed by the source. And in the case of authorization response, we have two options, hybrid flow or JAR that I have just opened. The JAR is a new specification which puts all the authorization response into JSON and protects them using JAR. So the send our authentications, receive our authentication, and message our authentication. So it's all good, right? So that's actually suitable for very high security kind of things as well. We actually have, in conjunction with the University of Stuttgart, did the formal analysis of it. We have set up a very some people say that it's unrealistically strong attacker, and we demonstrated that even against that kind of attacker, this profile is actually secure, right? And also, in the speed of RFC 6750, the token usage, we are actually mandating send a constraint token instead of bearer token, which is explained in 6750. You guys have heard of a bearer token, send a constraint token? Bearer token is like a metro ticket, right? If you drop it and somebody picks it up, you can actually use it against metro. Well, so that's in Paris metro, and that's Toronto metro, right? That's a bearer token. Sender constraint token is totally different. It's like international airline boarding pass. It's got your name on it, or in other cryptographic material in your case, and you also have to demonstrate that you are actually the entitled person. So if I drop my boarding pass and somebody else, for example Isabel, picks it up and bring it to the boarding gate, she's not going to be able to use the boarding pass because she don't have the face matching the passport, right? So that's the sender constraint token. And if you're using sender constraint token, even if the token has been stolen, the attacker cannot use it, so it's pretty safe. And in FAPI part 2, we are mandating the use of sender constraint token. One way to do it is using MTLS that I have just explained. The other one is token binding, which actually is still to be developed. There can be other types of sender constraint tokens, but we are just mandating the use of sender constraint tokens. Now, that was the direct approach. We are also working on decoupled approach as well. By the way, we are not working on the embedded approach as well, because that's not quite secure. And if you're using phishing-resistant credentials, it's not going to be usable there, because embedded approach is essentially a legitimized phishing. Right? So we are working there. But we are working on decoupled approach. It's called client-initiated back-channel authentication profile, CBAC. And first implementation draft was just ratified this August. We've got a link there, but you can read that. But basically, what it is doing is to involve offline users, right? The original use case for SIBA was in the call centers. When you call centers, for example, for financial transactions or something like that, you often are asked, all right, so what is your account number? That's one thing. What is your date of birth? And so on and so on. But that's public information, right? Attacker, if they do enough research, they can actually pass it, which is not good, right? So another working group at OpenID Foundation called Moderna Working Group started working on it. It was actually for the mobile carriers, the telcos. But in this case, a user makes a call to the this call center, and then call center agent says, instead of asking your data back, they ask, okay, I'm going to set push notification to your phone so that you can actually authenticate yourself. Right? So that's the experience that you're having there. And the same can, this can be actually applied on something like smart speakers, right? When you say something to Alexa, you know, and then the backend system may push, send you a push notification, and you authorize the transaction. Or that can be at the point of sales time, sometimes stores, right? And you could perhaps show your phone, your QR code, something like that, and the push notification comes to you and authorize the payment. Like that. And that's not my slide. It's created by a company called OpenID. I still, if I asked them, because I knew that they had one. So the how it works is that, you know, the user, for example, in this case, it's a smart speaker, says to the smart speaker the purchase ABC, and then the backend, it's going to be relayed back to the backend system, and backend system calls resource server that provides API, and then this backend system is called consumption device, and there's another authorization server that supports SIBA, and this consumption device actually asks for permission to the SIBA authorization server, right? And then the authorization server pushes notification to the authentication device, which is user's smartphone, and that system is asking for permission. Do you want to approve? And if the user says yes, I do approve, then the permission grant actually comes back to the consumption device from SIBA authorization server, and they can now call the API. That's how SIBA works. Now, in this case, it was just the smart speakers, but it can be called something agent. Or it can be just plain open bank as well. So the specs that we are creating at FAPI working group are in the form of checklist. So in this case, you can see, you know, 5.2.2, the authorization server shall support the blah, 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 right? The thing here on my screen is too small and I can't read it. Anyway, so the point is, the point I wanted to make was that, and then there's a bullet which says shall require blah 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 and so on and so forth. So everything is a number, it's a checklist. And they are actually tied back to the test suite that we are providing. So it's very cheap. It's very easy for you guys to actually demonstrate the compliance with specification. But don't worry, you'll get the slides. And also, in the case of FAPI, we are restricting the crypto requirements so that there's going to be better interoperability. Right? And they are now in the second implementer's draft, heading towards the final. There are a couple of to-do things, like wait till auth jar becomes RFC and refers it. And split out the tighten the integration with jar. Right? Jar's been pretty recent. Actually, it's written after the second implementer's draft. So, the integrations are already. Split out the clause 7 to make it an independent draft, which is actually now being brought into the IETF. There's the IETF Singapore meeting next week. Hopefully it's going to get up there. So the draft name is draft Loderstedt of PAR and of RA. And PAP split out token binding. I said token binding is a little bit, you know, in shaky kind of state because Chrome actually removed token binding support right now, so it's actually really difficult to deploy, so we may want to split out the separate draft longer for that. and just change the name of the part one and part two. Because there are read-only cases that deal with very sensitive data. So when we started doing this work, it was about financial data, right? It's quite restricted, they say. But after that, after a while, you know, people came to us, we want to use this for airline cross-border use case, we want to use it for healthcare use cases, things like that. And so that kind of changed our mindset a little bit. And for example, there are read-only cases that build very sensitive data, right? For example, in the case of healthcare. And read-write cases where the write application, write operation is not so high risk. So we are thinking of changing read-only security profile to high security profile, something like that, and read-and-write security profile to substantial or medium security profile. It's yet to be determined. If you've got a better name, please let me know, okay? All right, so other potential roles. Client registration, and that Gavin actually talked about a little bit. So UK Open Banking's been doing that, Australian CDS is doing it. Maybe there's, we've got registration spec, but that's generic, very generic for OpenID Connect and all. We may want to create a little bit more constraints to meet these needs. And the data schema. So US FDX is having its own data schema. UK Open Banking is having another data schema. If we can abstract a little bit to, and put it into the repeatable kind of specs, that might be useful. And then bringing rewrite profile to ISO, IC, JTC. By the way, I've got only 2 minutes left. And how can we tell that the implementation conforms to the specification? Test, of course, right? So OpenID Foundation offers FAPI Part 2 and SIBA Test Suite. You can go to those links and find out what it is. And once it passes all the tests, then implementers can self-certify and publish it to get an OpenID certified mark. And there are a bunch of certified products, implementations available now, and the number is increasing. And there are external liaisons as well. These are the kind of liaisons, like FData is one of our reasons. So we do talk very closely with ISO 2268, which, by the way, have started on QR code payment as well. And we are also setting up a liaison relationship with W3C for payments. Yeah. So that's for me. If you're interested and if you want to make an impact to this world, come join us. Thank you very much.
Very good call to action, Nat. Thank you. We might have time for a very quick question. Don't hesitate, yes, to change rooms if you